Okay, we have a great conference planned for you today, and to get started, I'd like to introduce the Executive Director of the YWCA Rock County, Angela Moore.
Thank you, Vicki. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
We are thrilled that you are here with us to learn, to collaborate, to work together. Our conference provides a venue to learn from and about one another, to begin or continue the dialogue, to engage in meaningful conversations in order to affect change in our own lives, our families' lives, our community, or our workplace. We bring together community stakeholders to work on eliminating racism at all levels and through an environment that encourages learning from and supporting each other in our common goals, this conference provides a platform for action planning, reflection, and community dialogue. What we'd like to do is to update you from our activities since last year, and we'll provide a very short snapshot. But how many of you were with us last year at our first conference? Would you stand? Good morning. Okay, take a minute. Please continue to stand. A few other instructions. Take a moment, please, and look around and introduce yourself to someone who is still seated, but make sure it is someone that you do not know. About if we add a little bit extra to this, you're not going to hear this but once today, and that is take out your cell phone. I'm going to ask you to silence it in just a moment, but take out your cell phone. Let's use social media in order to facilitate our introductions here in this room, but also in space. So share your thoughts. We'd like for you to share your thoughts about the conference, racial justice, ideas, comments, et cetera, on Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, and tag us at YWCA Rock County and use the hashtags that you see listed. So take a picture or a selfie, but take a picture with that person that you just introduced yourself to, that you just met. Say hello again and post it, okay? I'll give you a minute to do that. Okay, thank you. What fun. You know, I noticed not one person approached the podium to take a picture with me, but that's okay. So what have we done? What have you done since our last racial justice conference last November, 12 months ago, believe it or not? We're proud to continue this conversation around and about racial justice. We're happy that community action continues to work in this area and demonstrates daily why they were the recipients of the Dorothy Height Award last year. Let's give them a round of applause. They will forever go down in history as the recipient of the first ever Dorothy Height Award. And in addition, their own and our own, because we do claim him, he's on our committee, Mark Perry has helped educate numerous members of the Sheriff's Office about implicit bias, as well as conducting numerous other trainings. Rock County will lead a breakfast, a breakout session this morning to share how they built an inclusive workplace. Rock County embarked on a racial justice journey by continuing the dialogue at department head meetings at each staff level and dedicating resources to their racial justice outcomes. They invited our keynote speaker from last year, Alonzo Kelly, to speak to members of their staff and conducted interviews to measure their own cultural work climate. Alonzo was also invited to speak to the Blackhawk Human Resources Association for professional development. What else happened after last year? Us, the YWCA, we've been asked by members of the community to assist with organizational plans to infuse important elements of racial justice within the business and community culture. One example is our annual Stand Against Racism event, which included support from individuals, businesses, and local schools. We continue to build upon and grow our partnerships with many organizations, and we're proud of a new partnership with the Wisconsin Council on Children and Families to prepare a race to equity report for Rock County. And that's similar to the one that you heard last year if you were in attendance, that focused mainly on Dane County statistics as well as Wisconsin statistics at large. As we worked externally, we also focused internally. We know that this is a journey for us internally, YWCA Rock County, but also that if we don't take the first step, we will never, ever join the fight for this journey. I'm proud to say that my administrative team is 37% diverse, and our overall staff at YWCA Rock County exceeds the percentage of the diverse population in Rock County. We still have a ways to go, but we must also be proud of the milestones and the steps that we take. Our board is focused on diversity with their membership recruitment efforts, as well as providing the resources needed for us to live our mission, racial justice. And our mission is a powerful one. The mission at the YWCA is to eliminate racism, empower women, promote peace, justice, freedom, and dignity for all. We take our mission and the responsibility to demonstrate our efforts very seriously. We are proud to offer this conference as an example of living our mission. So as we come together today, after one of the most contentious elections in our history, let's focus on the strength of our differences as we travel together on this journey called life. Let's buckle our seatbelts. Let's get ready for this journey. I'd like to thank all of you for coming and your participation together. We are on a mission, YWCA, and I'm excited about our journey together. Thank you.
Thank you, Angela. At this time, I would like to introduce Elaine Schultz, board president for the YWCA Rock County, who will announce the winner of the prestigious Dorothy Height Racial Justice Diversity in the Workplace Award. Elaine.
Good morning. Thank you, Vicki. It is my distinct honor to stand in front of you today to present the Dorothy Height Racial Justice Diversity in the Workplace Award. Dorothy Height so personified the mission of the YWCA that I will read just a bit of her massive and impressive bio. Dorothy Height was born in Virginia in 1912. She spent her life fighting for civil and women's rights. She showed great talent as an orator in high school and became socially and politically active, participating in anti-lynching campaigns. She participated in many oratory competitions and won a college scholarship. She applied to and was accepted to Barnard College in New York, but as the start of the semester neared, the college changed their mind on her admittance, telling Dorothy they already met their quota for black students. Undeterred, she applied to New York University, where she would earn 2 degrees, a bachelor's degree in education in 1930 and a master's degree in psychology in 1932. After working for a time as a social worker, Height joined the staff of the Harlem YWCA in 1937. She had a life-changing encounter not long after starting work there. HeightMed educator and founder of the National Council of Negro Women, Mary McLeod Boothane, when Boothane and First Lady Eleanor Roosevelt came to visit the facility. One of Height's major accomplishments at the YWCA was directing the integration of the entire centers in 1946. She also established the YWCA Center for Racial Justice in 1965, which she ran until 1977. Through the centers and the council, she became one of the leading figures of civil rights movement. Height worked with Martin Luther King Jr., A. Philip Randolph, Roy Wilkins, Whitney Young, John Lewis, and Thames Farmer, sometimes called the Big Six of the civil rights movement. In 1936, Height was one of the organizers of the famed March on Washington. She stood close to Martin Luther King Jr. when he delivered the I Have a Dream speech. In 1971, she helped found the National Women's Political Caucus with Gloria Steinem, Betty Friedan, and Shelley Chisholm. While she retired from the YWCA in 1977, Height continued to run the NCNW for two more decades. One of her later projects was focusing on strengthening the African American family, and in 1986, she organized the first Black family reunion, a celebration of traditions and values, and the event is still held annually. Height received many honors for her contribution to society. In 1994, President Bill Clinton awarded her with a Presidential Medal of Freedom. In 2004, President George W. Bush gave Height a Congressional Gold Medal. She later befriended the first African-American president of the United States, Barack Obama, who called her the godmother of the civil rights movement. Height passed in Washington, D.C. on April 20th of 2010. To honor this remarkable woman's legacy, we have chosen to name our Racial Justice Award after her. The recipients of this award are required to demonstrate commitment to cultural diversity in the workplace and to show a commitment to cultural diversity as a high priority by establishing practices and policies that demonstrate an understanding for respect for culturally diverse work environments. We are proud to present the 2016 Dorothy Height Racial Justice Diversity in the Workplace Award to the School District of Beloit. Will Superintendent Tom Johnson please come forward?
Good morning. Quite an honor to be here today. I would like to thank Angela and her staff and all of those at the YWCA for this wonderful honor. I'd like to start by introducing some of the members of the staff that are with us today, if you would stand as I call your name. We have Executive Director of Human Resources, Deitra Salas, Executive Director of Business Services, Jamie Morath. Executive Director of Student Services, Emily Pels. Board of Education member, Pam Charles. Beloit Memorial High School Assistant Principal, Rosendo Amor. Director of Curriculum and Instruction, Dr. Jacqueline Jolly. And Converse Elementary Principal, Vicki Hamilton. Thank you. Assistant Superintendent Dr. Williams and Mr. Bonds could not be here with us today because as I speak here, they are leading a community veterans program at Beloit Memorial High School. This is honoring veterans from around our region, and we are humbled to be hosting today in our district Major General Marcia Anderson, who, as many of you know, was the first African-American female officer to earn the rank of Major General in the U.S. Army, Army Reserve, or National Guard. I would like to personally, and I haven't seen her yet, I haven't run into her, but I would like to personally thank Dorothy Harrell for the nomination of the School District of Beloit for this award and all of the work that she does in our community and all of the pushing that she does to make us better. In life, what you often give your attention to grows, and the School District of Beloit has given its attention to ensuring that diversity isn't a moniker or it isn't a word on a piece of letterhead. We have committed to utilizing our resources, be it human, be it fiscal, be it heartful, to recruiting and retaining a diverse workforce. This involves actively recruiting around this country, and it has actually involved around the world for us. The bottom line is that we believe that our faculty and staff should be far more representative of the community and our student population. We believe that it is imperative for students from all backgrounds to see, to know, and to learn from individuals who share their diversity and those that do not. Our Human Resources Office, under the leadership of Dietra Salas, in conjunction with Dr. Williams' Office of Administration, Operations, and Equity, have done an excellent job to continue to work to achieve this mission we have set forth. The right, and I would argue it is an ethical and moral right, to see individuals, a variety of professionals in an organization that reflect our population. All students benefit from a diverse workforce in our school district. And I would say that all people benefit from a diverse workforce in any organization. During the 2013 to 14 school year, our total minority hiring for all positions in the district was 14%. As of October 4th, 2016, for this school year, our minority hiring in all categories combined was 35%. Further, our Grow Your Own program, under leadership from a strong committee with Dorothy Harrell at the helm, and also a generous gift of $10,000 from former Senator Tim Cullen, jump-started our Grow Your Own scholarship to take students who we currently have in our district and help them to come back and represent our student population. We, as Dr. Williams said recently at a presentation, did not seek to go out to the masses first. We did not seek to go out to businesses and ask for donations for our scholarship. What we did is we started internally, and we asked our own employees at all levels in the organization to contribute. And I'm happy to say that as of this morning, when I last checked, we are nearing the $50,000 mark. It's quite simple. We made it important. We made it important, much like Dorothy Height chose in her own life to make education, racial justice, and family important. Dorothy Height was once quoted as saying, "We have to realize we are building a movement." The School District of Beloit is committed to our movement in continuing to recruit and retain professionals from all backgrounds, from all walks of life, to our organization who are effective in the work that they do each and every day with young people. I can say that as an organization, we are humbled by this award. I can also say again, we are grateful for the work of Angela Moore and the YWCA. And it is my hope that we can, in our district, serve as a model. And we still have a long way to go, but a model for all organizations in our region. What you give your attention to grows, and we have made diversity in the workplace crucial for our future, for our betterment, and for our entire community. Thank you again for this honor. I wish you a great day of learning, connecting, and pursuing racial justice for all. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Elaine, and congratulations to the School District of Beloit for the wonderful honor. What a deserving award. One of my favorite quotes from Dorothy Height in her memoir is, "We think we have segregation because of prejudice, but I believe it's the other way around. We have prejudice because of segregation." Teresa Craig, chair of the Speakers Selection Subcommittee and a former board member, will now introduce our keynote speaker.
Good morning. I have the extreme pleasure of introducing your keynote speaker this morning and a speaker that we will have and enjoy the rest of the day. Kalan R. Haywood Sr. is the founder and president of Vanguard Group, LLC in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. He is the assiduous visionary of a leading national real estate investment and development firm. In this role, he is responsible for the procurement of debt and equity financing for new and existing real estate development, internal operations, business development, and the overall performance of Vanguard's growing portfolio. His road to success was not an easy one. Poverty and violence are just a few of the obstacles Haywood had to beat growing up in Milwaukee. In addition to leading Vanguard, Haywood is most fulfilled when positively impacting the lives of others, imparting knowledge about business and life, and sharing his personal journey of overcoming diversity and adversity. As a dedicated leader and supporter of community, his areas of concentration span from real estate development, economic development, racial justice, and issues related to strengthening and building communities. After Kalan addresses you this morning, we will have an opportunity for questions. I would ask any in the audience, if you have a question, to make your way right behind the projector here, as there will be a microphone and the group can hear at that time. Without further ado, I would like to introduce Kalan Haywood Sr.
Well, good morning. One more time. Good morning. There we go. I'm excited to be here and to hear the superintendent speak of the award that they just received is a good way to set the tone this morning for what I think is going to be an impactful day. First and foremost, I want to thank Therese. I'm not going to say Teresa, because you asked me this morning how to say my name, and I said Kalan. She got up here and said Kalan. So it's Kalan. But Teresa, Beverly, Vicky, the entire YWCA staff, I want to thank you for your commitment. I want to thank you for your dedication. I speak at a lot of places around the country, and a lot of conferences, a lot of corporation events. The topic always ranges from real estate development to entrepreneurism to community development to fatherhood, but rarely is the topic ever one such as racism. Racism is an important but fragile topic. It's an important but very delicate topic. It's not tasteful if you really want to get into it. Talking about racism reminds me of the whole adage of how they make the hot dogs. Everybody loves a good hot dog. But if you get to know how it was made, how it got there, that's the part you don't want to know. So I commend the YWCA for having the fortitude, the foresight, the vision to make this second annual conference a reality. And although I wish you much success in many more conferences, truth be told, I hope that future conferences are not about racial justice. I hope we find a way to solve it. So 10 years from now, the conference, we all can gather, we can all convene, but maybe the topic is something different. So thanks again, YWCA. Give them a round of applause. I also want to thank each and every one of you sitting out in the audience today. The very fact that you're here this morning is a testament to your zeal to be part of a discussion, to be part of a conversation, to be part of a solution. It may seem simple that you're here this morning, but the fact of the matter is, without you being here, and I don't mean just anybody, I mean the very people that we have in the seats, this is part of God's purpose. The reason you're here today is because this is part of God's plan. And I sincerely hope that each and every one of you are here because we're committed to being part of a solution. So I want to I want you to give yourselves a round of applause as well. So, let's see here. Jeff, you get me keyed up? So, as said earlier, I'm the president and founder of Vanguard Development Group. Vanguard is a real estate development investment firm. I founded this firm over 17 years ago. And since that time, we've been in the trenches, investing and developing some of the toughest but most inspiring communities around the country. We work in over 26 U.S. markets and have, in our opinion, become experts in developing unique and diverse capital stack solutions and unique and diverse development team partnerships that mirror the unique and diverse character of the communities we work in. We're proud of the fact that we've taken on some very challenging projects, but we're most proud of the fact that we charge ourselves daily to use our business as a vehicle to enhance and improve the lives of those who live, work, and play in and around the projects we develop. I tell people all the time that, yes, my day job is real estate development and investment. So my focus is, yes, to build buildings, to build structures, to improve our built environment. But my passion, better yet, my obligation, is to build people and to build opportunities and to improve our social environment. That's my passion. It's how I can act in my station. It's the power that I have. So I was telling my friends and family and colleagues that I would be here today to speak about the topic of race and racial justice and inclusion. And they were all eager to give me ideas of what I should talk about or what I should not talk about. They were all eager to give me bullet points on what we should leave on the table and leave off the table. They were very encouraging. And then, one by one, they would all ask, Kalan, where is this conference being held? And I would say with a whisper, Janesville. They would ask again, where? And I would say, Janesville. Say, Janesville, like Janesville, Wisconsin? I say, yeah, Janesville, Wisconsin. And I mean, when I say everybody, I mean everybody. My mama. My mother recently had a medical issue, and I had her in the hospital last week. We're sitting in the emergency room in her bed, and we're talking about the conference. And my mother was born in Memphis, Tennessee, and my grandmother was born in Yazoo City, Mississippi. So I think they know a little bit about racial injustice. And so she says, well, I'm glad you're going there. Now, might I add, she just had quadruple bypass surgery. She's back in the ER 2 days later, and she says, she's been talking real faint since she left the hospital. And she says, well, where is it at? I said, it's Janesville. I won't repeat what she said because we have kids here, but she said, you sure you want to go there? I said, yeah. One by one, everyone started to remind me or tell me, inform me of how Janesville was the capital of the white supremacist seat in Wisconsin, and that if I go to Janesville, I should go only in the daytime. If I go to, I mean, this is real comments. If I go, I should only go at night. If I go, I should come home after the conference. So I had to shoot back. I had to think of something witty to say. What could I say witty about Janesville? I said, well, you know, Janesville is known for other stuff as well. They're like, what? Give me one thing. So, well, you know, it is the home of the Speaker of the House, Paul Ryan. That's all I had. That's all I had. But when I go back home now, I think I'm going to be able to go back and tell a different story. But that situation, those situations show you that regardless if someone has been there or engaged with people or felt it firsthand, history, historical events, and perceptions play a huge part in how they engage with other people. Whether it's totally false or whether it's totally true, perceptions are key to how people interact and interact and engage with people. So what makes Kalan Haywood qualified to be here today? What do I bring, what relevancy can I bring to the table to talk about racial injustice? This is me, this little guy here. A kid born in a neighborhood which is now known as Brewers Hill in Milwaukee. And I can tell you when I was a kid, the Brewers Hill in Milwaukee that everybody flocks to now, that everybody wants to live in, wasn't the same Brewers Hill when I was a kid. I cannot recall seeing many white men in my neighborhood when I was a kid. unless they came to pick up the rent or unless they were police officers. But to give you a little background on who I am, I'm going to tell you a story. The story is about me and my childhood best friend. Now, I'm pretty sure many of you had a childhood best friend, and you may even still be best friends with that individual to this day. But me and my best friend had so many common things that kept us close, that kept our bond tight. We were both the same age. We were both Sagittarius, the best sign. We were both born into single-parent families. We were both raised in poverty. We both grew up in the same neighborhood. We both experienced some of the same trials and tribulations. We also attended the same school, and I can recall going to and from school, having discussions about what we would do when we grew up, how we would make a change for our community, how we would do something impactful. We were really innocent youth with all the zeal and true vision of living the American dream. As we entered our teenage years, our mother and grandmothers did their best to prepare us for the real world. They wanted to do everything certain to make sure that we did not succumb to the negative forces that were readily at play right outside our front door. But I can tell you, those teenage years were the years where my friend and I began to separate. We began to experience different things that took our lives in different paths. For me, I had a strong support team. A support team comprised of my mother, my grandmother, my aunts, some uncles, and a few family friends. They got me involved in activities. They stressed the importance of getting a good education. They taught me arts and crafts. I was involved in extracurricular activities. They were instrumental in getting me into good schools. I always attended schools for the gifted and talented. I've always been good at academics, so much so that when I was younger, I skipped a grade, and I think I graduated as one of the youngest people in my senior class. My friend, on the other hand, my friend started out associating with his older cousins, his older uncles, the cool guys from the neighborhood. He started being associated and exposed to guns and drugs and violence and an array of other criminal activity. And although I know that he knew it was wrong, I can only suspect that the whole allure of the street life was kind of overwhelming for him. I can recall that as I enrolled in and then went off to the University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee to study architecture and urban planning, that same time my friend, who was like my twin, was involved in violence, drugs, and firearms. Our lives continued to travel along this crazy Twilight Zone type of parallel. When I was in high school, I got an internship. I got an internship at the City of Milwaukee in the Department of Buildings and Bridges. Before then, I had no knowledge of city government, didn't really pay attention to it. And this is back in the day before email, and so when they wanted something delivered, I delivered it. But what it did is it got me familiar and let others be familiar with who I was as a kid. After high school, I got a job with an architectural firm called Epstein Ewan Architects, which is now, at the time it was a very small firm, but now it's Wisconsin's largest firm. And the CEO there, Sam Epstein, he saw something in me that I didn't see in myself, which is one of the key points that I want to talk about today. Someone else seeing something in you that you may not see in yourself. But he afforded me opportunity to follow him around and learn. And as a kid, I had no clue what I was listening to and learning. But being around that conversation, being around dialogue, being exposed to it, exposure is key. Exposure is key to how we start to develop our perceptions. Sam allowed me to work with him and shadow him, which was, for me, one of the best pieces of my life. But that same year, later that year, my best friend was arrested, convicted, and sentenced to 3 years in the Wisconsin State Prison System for possession of firearms and narcotics. I remember during his incarceration, we talked daily, if possible, about what he would do when he got out, how he would start to fulfill his truest potential, how he would be encouraging and inspiring and be a true asset to the community. As time went on, I was introduced to many opportunities which eventually lit my entrepreneur fire. So I read every book about the greatest companies and their founders. I studied all the how-to manuals on business startups and funding, preparing myself for the day that I can start a company that I was hopeful would get me out of the situation I was born into, but also be a catalyst and a beacon of hope for the people I grew up around. My friend was eventually released from jail, but it seemed that his focus was the same place it was previously. This time he picked up right where he left off, but this time he had more passion, more zeal, and more street credibility than he had before. For me, he was still a good friend of mine, again, like a twin, and talking to him was like looking in the mirror. So I went to him and said, listen, I'm thinking about starting this business. What do you think? He encouraged me. He looked at me and said, you should do it. You should use our childhood experiences as the motivator. I think you'll do well. See, I knew that if anyone knew the yin and yang, the checkerboard, the black and white of who I was as a person, it would be him. We all have a yin and yang. We all have a black and white. We want the white, or I shouldn't say, talking about race, I gotta be careful here. But we want the good side to definitely outweigh the bad side. So I did just that. I started my company. The company was flourishing. It was very difficult. It was challenging. It was tough, but it was going in the right direction. And plus, I had been blessed with a beautiful new baby boy. Oh, skip a slide. That's me and my grandmother graduating. These women here are from Jasmine, Mississippi, and Memphis, Tennessee. And again, they kind of make who you are. This is where you start your beginning. Oh, so anyway. So this is a baby boy I was blessed with, my son, Kalan Haywood II. And he became the main reason, the main motivator for me wanting to right our situation, for me wanting to get out of poverty, for me wanting to be an example. So again, another lesson is we have to find something to latch on to. We have to find something more important than ourselves. Sometimes when you don't feel as eager to be part of the fight, sometimes when you don't feel as eager to be part of the struggle, you may want to give up. But if you have something that you believe in, that you care about more than yourself, you're more reluctant to give up. And this was my reason here. Our lives were moving in the right direction. Things were going well. I was a young entrepreneur, and I had a son to raise and be a good example to. And then boom, my world changed in an instant. I remember it like it was yesterday. My friend was shot 9 times. I still get chills when I think about it. I can remember the day. I remember it like it was yesterday. Hot summer day, middle of July. Matter of fact, Wednesday, July 12th, 2 p.m. to be exact. And my world changed forever. Since then, I've went on to grow a successful business that is really founded on the principle of being an example to others. I've had the chance and opportunity to use my story time and time again to hopefully encourage and promote positivity, a story that people don't have to let where they come from determine where they're at, that your trial can be your triumph, where there's oppression, there's opportunity. But still, daily, every morning in the mirror, I'm compelled to think of my best friend. Every single morning in the mirror. Because through our relationship, through that yin and yang, I developed to the man I am today. I try to keep his name alive. It's important to me to keep his name alive. Can anybody in this room tell me where they think my friend is today? Anybody? Show of hands. Raise your hand. What is it? In the ground. Anybody else? Working with me. That's a good one. Anybody else? Give me one more. Prison. Kind of a story for young black men. But if I promise to tell you his name, would you promise to remember? Can I get that from you? His name is Kalan R. Haywood, Sr. I am him. I am that friend that made some mistakes, took the wrong path at times, was blessed with so many opportunities, had so much potential, was always smart, but still at times made the wrong choice. But I had people around me that didn't give up. I had people around me that cared about me more than I did about myself at certain times. We all know somebody like that. We got a cousin or a brother or a coworker or a friend or a neighbor. We all know someone that has at some time shown potential, but may have erred. Where would I be without Tyrone Dumas, who gave me my job at the City of Milwaukee? Where would I be without Sam Epstein giving me a job at Epstein Ewing? Where would I be without Judge Maxine White, who is now Chief Judge of the First District, who sentenced me to prison, who people laugh at me and say, how is Maxine White your best friend? She sent you to jail. Well, she probably saved my life. See, there is no bad. You can't take God's graces and blessings a la carte. You don't get to choose what you like about your blessings. And when things don't go your way, you think he fell asleep at the wheel. Because he did not. He never falls asleep at the wheel. It's all part of a plan, but you have to do your part. And you all are doing your part today because you're here. So that is my truth. This little guy is the little guy that you saw before. This is my son. And I'm proud of him. Because he came from a seed that didn't know anything about city government. He is the youth council president of the city of Milwaukee. This picture's from last year, but I get emotional about it. Last night, he actually won re-election for the second time. And thank you very much. Thank you very much. But the glory is to God, and my son is committed and dedicated. And as you move forward, as he moves forward, I'm going to tell you a little story about him quickly. Part of his job as a youth counselor is to really set the tone for youth, for teens, for young adults. Recently, he went to a location up north, and they have a youth court. And his thing is really teen justice, social justice, and racial justice. And he thinks there's a disparity in how young teens of color are sentenced in the court system. So he adopted this idea from this northern city or town to bring back to Milwaukee. And I'm pleased to say that earlier this year, the city of Milwaukee Common Council voted into legislation that we would not have a youth court where youth would be judged by their peers for misdemeanor offenses. The intent is to keep them out of the court system as long as possible. And if they can do the volunteer service, show that they're right at their ways. But I hope that when I look back, part of my discussion with him as a kid played a part in how he feels about life today. Many of you, when I gave the ending to my story, I heard gasp in the room. Well, the fact of the matter is, we all have a truth. I just happen to share mine. Everyone in this room has a story. Some are willing to share, some may be willing to not share. But I encourage you to use your story as the foundation and the guide to how you attack any issue. And when you attack an issue such as racial injustice, you need a strong foundation. I often tell people that as we build buildings, the buildings are beautiful, and people see the buildings from the ground up. They see many floors that they are in awe. But before we start to dig, it's important for us to test the soil to understand what we're digging upon. We bore, take samples, ascertain and understand. What are we building upon? And sometimes the soil is not right, so we have to strengthen the soil. Sometimes the soil is contaminated, so we have to move the soil. But it's the foundation of how we start to build our buildings. Doesn't like me today. So today I want to pose to you a question. And the question I have is, what can we do as individuals? What can we do from our own experiences? What can we do in our own stations to help push the needle forward? Now, you have those people that like to be out front. You get those individuals that like to lead the march, the individuals with the bullhorns, the megaphones, the microphones. You have individuals that don't mind being in front of the cameras and lights. But what about the individuals that are introverts and prefer to be behind the scenes? What about the individuals that want to work alongside someone and just be supportive of the cause? Each and every one in this room can play a part. If you're the man or woman with the bullhorn, or if you're the person at your desk or at your dining room table, where true discussion about racial justice happens, you know, some people are up in arms about the election we had 2 days ago. And the truth is, change doesn't start in Washington, D.C. Change doesn't start in Madison, Wisconsin. Change doesn't start in your city hall. Change starts in your home, in your mind, in your heart. Change then permeates through your dining room table, into your neighbors, into your coworkers. So we pick up the paper. Actually, I think there are four key components that I look to that people can possess and execute to really move the racial needle forward. I call them the four C's. The four C's. The first C being conscious. People have to be conscious of not just where they are, but where we've been and where you want to go. You have to be conscious of our history. You have to be conscious of how things we say or do can affect the other person. The second C, a person must be committed. It may seem like a no-brainer, but as I said earlier, if you are not committed, if a person is not committed, when times get tough and the going gets rough, you may want to give up. You may say, you know what? I went to the conference in November. That's enough for now. But you must stay committed. Third C. The third C is a person must care. A person must care about things that don't necessarily affect them directly in their day. But when you hear the news of 100 miles away or 90 miles away, that in the course of a weekend, 12 black men in Milwaukee were murdered, you have to care. So what is not in Janesville? So what is not in Beloit? We must find a way to care. I was recently speaking somewhere, and it was about mass murder in institutions and schools. And I was compelled to just change the dialogue a little bit, because we think of mass murder as somebody walking into a place and gunning down many folk on one occasion, Tampa and Sandy Hook. But what about in the course of 1 year, 300 black men being murdered? Is that mass murder? It is. And that's what Chicago stats look like. So we have to care about these things, even though they're outside of our front yard. Fourth C, a person must be courageous. A person must be courageous. You must be willing to look bigotry and racism in the face and speak to it. Every time you speak to it, it doesn't have to be forceful or violently. But if someone says something, you can kindly say, hey, bruh, that ain't cool. It may seem like a simple act, but over time, it will start to have an effect. So, when you turn on your TV or you pick up a newspaper or you peruse through social media, and I'm going to get back to the four C's in just a minute, but I want you to understand that before we get into going forward, we got to understand where we're at and where we came from. So as you pick up the paper and you look at the headlines and you go on social media and blogs and you see some of the nastiest conversation, the keyboard talk, you begin to understand that racism is in every part of our lives. Of course, it's in our politics. Now, he's our president now, and I had to slide in before Tuesday, so I wasn't going to take it out. Whether you like it or not, whether you like him or not, the fact of the matter is, when a person of power or influence calls a group of people criminals or rapists or drug dealers, it's hurtful to the cause. In no way can you believe that this moves the needle forward. No matter how you look at it, no matter how you spin it, I can tell you now as a black man, and I won't speak for every black man. Yes, I will. That I understand politics well. I get it. I have a 12-year-old daughter as well. It's very difficult to talk to my daughter about the results of the election. Even though I understand politics, I get it. It's very difficult as a CEO, as a president of a company, to figure out in my mind, how do I address sexual harassment when it comes up again, if it ever comes up again? It's difficult. Had a coworker of mine yesterday, a colleague of mine, he owns a grocery store. Many of his employees are Latino. He said the morale yesterday was so low. Not low because they were just disappointed, because they're scared. This is how it converts to real life. This is the morning after. But then we're here 2 days later talking about racial justice. Next slide. Racism is also present in our law enforcement and community relationships. And I see we have some law enforcement officers here today. But imagery, we all heard of Black Lives Matter. We've all seen what happened in Ferguson, Missouri. This is a true fear. And I wanted to put this on a slide today because I knew I was in Janesville and I want you to see it firsthand. I was sitting down recently with a very prominent CEO of a very large global company, a guy I like a lot. His company probably has 20,000 employees, if not more, and he's the boss. It's a good thing. And a few weeks ago, we were having dinner, and in our discussion, we started talking about racism. A man that I respect, a man that I like, a man I've done business with, said to me, first, he said that he thought that President Obama having a beer conversation a few years back was an example of racism. Then he went on to say, and this was his gesture, all that stuff with Mike Brown and don't shoot is a bunch of garbage. Not the word he used, but that's what he said. This is the one that hurt the most. He said, again, CEO of a company with 20,000 employees said, when President Obama said that Trayvon Martin could be my son, he was saying, screw me. My brother there faced his turn. How do you even get that? How does that even, now again, this is not someone with poor education or not. This is a CEO of a company, highly educated, well-traveled man. How dangerous is it to have the CEO of a company feel that way? I asked the question, I said, how did you get that? He said, well, to me, I think he should have stayed out of it. But I said, no, go back. How did you get that the president was saying, screw you, by saying Trayvon could have been his son. And he went on to try to explain, and what I realized from the conversation was we were speaking two different languages. Speaking two different languages. He didn't make it up. He wasn't trying to prompt argument with me. When he said his, when he made a statement, he was telling the truth. That's how he really felt. So I start to think in reverse. How do white people feel when they see that? Maybe they hear something different or see something different when they see that. How do you move forward? How do you really achieve racial justice if we're talking two different languages? We have to find the common language. Next slide. It's present on our school, college campuses, school, our public schools and college campuses. Now, people say racism, this is a post-civil rights era, right? Everybody knows of Camp Randall Stadium. Two Saturdays ago, in Madison, Wisconsin, somebody thought it was a good idea to put a mask of your president on, go to a public stadium, put a noose around your neck. Now I'm gonna tell you what a true crime is. The true crime is not the idiot that did it. Camp Randall holds 80,000 people. These two guys here, how do you achieve racial justice? That happened. How does an individual feel so comfortable to do that? If we don't think there's a problem, then we're missing the point. We can convene here all day long. We can get 200, 250 people together. If that's not an issue, that's not on Instagram, that's not a selfie of him in his bedroom in his house. He walked into a stadium. Forget if it was Obama, it's a black man with a noose around his neck. The crime is the other 79,000 some people that didn't say anything. Oklahoma City, and I'm going this route for a reason, I get to it. Oklahoma City, school bus full of fraternity students, and they sing a racial song. I'm a black man, and I got a few other black men in the room. If I'm wrong, you can raise your hand and correct me. Black people don't got a song for white people. We don't got one. If you gave me $1 million, I couldn't think of a song. I couldn't make up a song right now that another black man knew. How do you get a group of people on the bus and everybody knows the song? You can hang them from a tree. Again, the crime is, not everyone, someone videotaped it, but many people on the bus joined in. And then afterwards, they apologized. The apology is not accepted. Next slide. It's probably not sports. Kaepernick's jersey being burnt. How do two different people hear the same thing? One says thank you, and one burns the jersey. Are we speaking the same language? I think not. I think not. It's in sports, it's in entertainment, it's in our politics, it's even in our religion. How do you get away from it? See, this is where I struggle. The point where I'm at right now is where I struggle. Because I can prepare a speech that everybody will like. The fact of the matter is we got to address the monkey in the room. I said before, there is no song that a black man knows about white people. If I'm around a bunch of black men and they do some craziness, most black people say something about it. When a black boy is murdered by a cop, You trying to tell me that every white person on the planet feels like that was justified? But we never hear from them. It will continue to happen because when a black boy is murdered, people think it's okay, and they expect me to say something about it because I'm a black man. But you know what would be so profound? If some white person said, hey, that don't seem right. I'm in a room with a bunch of people that I truly believe are sincere about moving this thing forward. You don't got to be here. But going back to one of those four C's, courage. You got to say, hey, something's wrong here. I'm going to tell you this. In my church, I love my church. I can tell you, in my church, we got some goofballs. I love my employees. I can tell you, in my office, there are some employees that are knuckleheads. You cannot tell me that every cop you get the point. It's important to call it out, no matter where it rests, no matter where it hides. You got to call it out. Otherwise, you will have 100 conferences about racial injustice. The needle will never move. I want to go back a little bit. I want to go back through our country's history, going back to the abolition of slavery. Again, a point I'm going to make. From the abolition of slavery and that crazy conversation that evolved around it, fast forwarding 100 years to a landmark Supreme Court decision, Brown versus the Board of Education, that said separate schools were inherently unequal. Fast forward another decade to the Civil Rights Act. Each step of the way that progress was made, or we think progress was made, it wasn't done because somebody woke up and morally felt like, you know what, this is wrong. Every time progress has been made, it's been done because of a fight. So in any relationship, husband and wife, employee and boss, supervisor, you name one. Name a relationship you can think of that if I fight for my equality in it, we can still move on and be cool from there. If a wife has to fight her husband for respect, and then he eventually gives it after she bled for it, then we just move forward, I still feel some kind of way. I still got a problem. I understand that you didn't give it to me because you really believed it. You gave it to me because I wouldn't give up. There's not a time in our history where racism has not been more polarizing than it is now. To put some perspective on this whole thing, because people again say that, get over it, man. That was like my ancestors. That wasn't me. The fact of the matter is, how many people in this room would classify themselves as millennials? Anybody? One, two, three? Couple millennials in the room. How many people in the room would classify themselves as Generation Xers, including myself? Okay. How many people in this room would classify themselves as baby boomers? What it means, why is that relevant? It means that if you're a millennial, it means that you're only 1 year removed. I'm sorry, if you're a millennial, you're only two generations removed. You're only two generations removed from a time when it was mandated that public places be segregated. Public bathrooms, public transportation. This ain't ancient history, two generations ago. If you're a Generation Xer, what does it mean? It means that you're only one generation removed from a time where a young man was murdered for allegedly whistling at a white girl. It means you're only one generation removed from a time when people were gunned down with water hoses and attacked by police dogs. If you're a baby boomer, what does it mean? It means you're not removed. You were born into it. You lived through it. You lived at a time where a court, a law had to tell you that people of color could vote. It was still okay prior to 1964 to question someone's ability to vote based on the color of their skin. I'm not saying all this to badger anybody. Again, it's the hot dog. Don't talk to me about racial justice if we can't talk about how we got here, how we made it. I'm gonna tell you, the other side is so much better than this side. But we gotta dig through this side first. You gotta understand it. And I understand, I get it. Because when I do something wrong, sometimes it's very difficult for me to talk about it. I'm just being honest. When I know that I messed up and it was something so silly and stupid, I have a hard time, because when it comes out your mouth, it sounds like, man, did I really do that? But it's important to know where we came from. It's important to know how we got here. So that's one thing, the history of it. The other thing is important to note, do we all understand what racism is? We are at a conference for racial justice. Do we even understand what racism is? I think sometimes we confuse racism with being prejudiced. I think sometimes we confuse racism with being bigots. It's important. This is an important part of this conversation. It's very difficult, institutional-wise, for minorities to be racist or to exact or implement racism. Tell you why. Racism inherently brings with it a sense of power, influence, authority. See, black people can be prejudiced. I could think that white people are whatever. I could have many ideas that are silly about white people. That's a prejudice. White people can believe that because I'm a felon or because I went to jail or because I came from a single parent family that I'm a thief, a crook. If you're Mexican, that you're a rapist or a drug dealer. That's a prejudice. That's not racism. It becomes racism when I can use my prejudice to decide to influence your life in a negative way. We can all leave here with some prejudice, and we all have it some kind of way. We all have been taught some prejudice. But it doesn't become an act of racism until it's done by someone that can literally oppress somebody else. The HR director, the interviewer, the CEO, the judge, most frighteningly, the police officer. That's what racism is. And I think, again, having a discussion where we don't truly understand that we're talking two different languages. Racism can only be opposed. Now, I can be fair and say, I truly believe that you can have black people that are racist against black people. If you are in a place, a position of authority that can influence my progress, but because you believe something about me and you act upon it, then black people can be racist against black people. But institutional-wise, in schools, in our criminal justice system, in our prison system, it's inherently run by a group of people that don't look like me. Last week, I was at a school, earlier this week, and a bunch of fourth graders. And the fourth graders were having their election, their mock election for the president. And afterwards, we were talking. Three black kids, one young white girl, fourth grade. And we're talking about who they voted for. And unlike adults, these kids, like, they don't care. They tell you, right? Like, so, one of the black kids said, you know, I voted for Hillary. The young white girl says, I didn't vote for Hillary. My mom said, Hillary's a crook. My mom said. We all know that. We influence our kids. You got a fourth grader that can be influenced to do anything in the world. And she has their mind made up already about a political party and a candidate. She then goes on to say that I wanted to vote for Marco Rubio, but he wasn't on the ballot. A fourth grader. The lesson for me there is, and I think we all know it, is that we have to be very careful what we pour into our kids. What we think maybe locker room talk, or dining room table talk with other adults, the next generation is listening. How do you have racial justice if we come here today, but yet we go home and we give our kids these prejudices? How's that work? I'm here because you're here, and we all want to move the thing forward. But the autopsy has to be performed. We have to perform the autopsy on how we got here and what we do and what we should stop doing. What is racism? You can believe whatever you want to believe when you leave here. The minute you act on it in a negative way, they can hinder somebody else. That's the act of racism. Going back to being conscious of our past. Recently, me and my team, we polled 100 white people. And we asked the question of, can you explain to me what the Civil Rights Act was about? About 5% knew the answer. I'll be honest, we polled 100 black people. And only about 20% knew the correct answer. They had some generalities. But we have to be conscious. We have to understand where we come from, how we got here. I keep repeating that. And there's no better teacher to the next generation or to our coworkers than ourselves. I always say that people that have been blessed with a position of influence are obligated to educate themselves, because you have a flock of people that take your word as law. Whatever you believe and you speak, they think it's the truth. Think about it, being conscious. Before I told you my story, when I came up here, you had no idea it was me, because some people already had an idea of what a felon looks like. Am I true? Is that correct? It wasn't true. I told that story for a reason, because you can't judge a book, and it's so simple, kindergarten stuff. You can't judge a book by its cover. Think about how, if we actually took the time to think back, when were we first introduced to racism? Because we weren't born with it. You don't come out the womb thinking this way. Somebody taught you that. A brother, a friend, a neighbor. Real quick, I was at UW-Milwaukee. I had a roommate my freshman year, white guy, Scott, still remember his name. Scott was a good dude. I had never heard Red Hot Chili Peppers until Scott. He gave me his tape. I gave him a tape of NWA. We were very cool dudes. Then as the year went on, Scott was talking to me less and less. And eventually he would not come into our suite. I would go in the hallway, he would be sitting on the floor doing his work. And I said, something all right. I assumed there was something going on at home that he didn't want to talk about. So I didn't want to push him. A few weeks later, I'm in my room, sleep, 3 a.m., the door burst open. It's campus police, Milwaukee police, guns drawn. They came and arrest me. Scott had told them that I threatened him. We had never had an argument, ever. Come to find out, after they searched his room and his stuff, he had all this white supremacist information that was handed out to him on the campus. And it influenced him to act in a way. This is a kid that came into college pure, I'm assuming. A good kid. We got along well. We would sit up in a room and watch SportsCenter to a kid that didn't want to talk to me anymore. And told the police that I threatened him. So, of course, I didn't get charged with anything. But the fact of the matter, another lesson taught in my life is somebody really went out and willfully gave him information that make him hate somebody else. On a college campus. Where is that information being spread? What was that? Fox News. Fox News. He's right. But I think it's on a lot of news media. And I also think it's on social media a lot. You saw a picture of Camp Randall Stadium. That should be the one to stick out the most. We've all been there. It's our Badgers. We wear Badger clothes. You got Wisconsin gear on right now. And somebody let him walk in, and they said he walked through ticket check-in with the mask on and the noose on. He didn't put it on once he got in. He had it on. And nobody thought that was weird. That wouldn't fly in Milwaukee. It wouldn't fly in Chicago. So when people get comfortable because they're around, they feel they're around like-minded individuals. You know, you get friends that when they have a goofy idea, the people in this room, you typically say, hey man, we're not doing that. His friend went with him. His friend, by the way, had a Donald Trump mask on and he was holding the noose. Take time, read the article. And you walked this man around and that was cool. I'm gonna speed it up here. My slides went down, I kind of got all off topic. The next C, committed. Committed for me means the people in this room hopefully can infect another 200 people. We have to be champions of the cause to get an award. You know, the stats from 14% to 37%, that's being implemented, that's excellent. Now somebody else needs to adopt that best practice. Talk to them, how was it done? Be committed to learning. We heard something that was powerful and impactful, but very few of us would go to him and say, hey, how was that done? And I can tell you, without even talking to him, that everybody on this ship didn't agree. You gotta move them around. I call it pruning a tree. The tree gotta be pruned every now and then. The tree can't not grow healthy with bad branches, but I will tell you this. You will never find a case in life where the branch will readily remove itself from the tree. The branch needs the tree. But if you want to affect change, you have to remove the branch if it's unhealthy. And it may hurt a little bit because it's a friend, it's a coworker, it's a family member. But racism and bigotry cannot exist anywhere. You have to stay committed. You gotta care. Now, on each slide you see, there's a picture of a building, and I had a story that I was gonna get into, but because I only got 2 minutes left, I'm gonna, but on each of those projects that we've built or I've shown, there was an example that I want to provide to you of where we were met with extreme racism. Why my backyard? I will tell a quick story about a project. We had a black laborer on the site. My job is in communities, I always say to my team, please hire from the community. Walk on the block, if you see a guy that ain't working, regardless of what color they are, if you see a guy not working, you hire him. We can't build in communities without employing the people. They can't walk past our projects and see us building and not be part of it. When people touch something and build it, they have pride in it. So I get a phone call from another colleague of mine from a different business. He says, I think you have a problem at one of your sites. So what is it? Well, this young man gave us a call and said that he feels that he's being treated different because he's black. Okay, I look into it. I contact the individual, he tells me what happened. I was kind of appalled, but I was not surprised. I called a meeting between he and the alleged perpetrator. Now, what was said is that the white guy was making comments to him as, on payday, for example, he said, don't spend it all in one place. You nigger rich now. Working on one of the floors doing some carpentry, he said, make sure you do it correctly, don't nigger rig it. Okay, now I have a zero tolerance policy for any of that. So we called a meeting between the black guy and the white guy. The black guy in the meeting, right before the meeting started, he repeated to me everything that was said. I said, cool. We get in the meeting with he and some other contractors, his supervisor, and I said, well, tell him what you told me. Quiet, silence. He felt threatened. He felt he would lose his job. See, a lot of times for black boys, every time we saw a white man growing up, it was a man in the position of authority. The principal, the police officer, the judge. And that thing carries on with you for some time. So I spoke up and said, well, this is what he said, you said. And I was assuming the white guy would say, man, I didn't say that. He says to me, yeah, I said that. I was just playing. No hesitation in owning it. He said, I said it. We joke around all the time. We're on a construction site. Again, are we even talking the same language? You thought that was okay to say? I get many, many examples. Many, many examples. I have too many examples. When I came here to talk today and talk about these four C's, I want to come here and be radiant in this beam of sunshine. But you can't do that all the time. Again, what I said at the beginning, racism is important but delicate. People want to talk about it but not talk about it. You know, like that cousin you got that's a weird dude that we know he's our cousin, but we're not going to talk about what he did. And lastly, courageous. Now, I kept this slide last for a reason, and I kept the building that's associated with it for a reason. The building is called the Germania. Get time, Google it. The Germania. The building was built in 1865. It was the first German newspaper headquarters in the United States. It's the world headquarters. And this building sits downtown Milwaukee. When I set about to redevelop this building, to purchase and redevelop this building, a black kid coming from a very poverty-stricken neighborhood had never experienced true racism until this project. I walked into an office that some guys called me to a meeting. They called me to their office. Guys that I knew, people that I knew, these were not strangers. And they said to me, why don't you just walk away from the Germania? I said, why is that? We don't think you should do that deal down here. Okay, why? Still didn't tell me why. Well, we don't think that a black guy is ready to own a building downtown. These are white dudes that I even learned from. This is when it comes out. So you can push hard enough. You keep pushing hard enough, you'll expose it. It was cool when I was doing the houses over here. Now I'm in your playground. It don't feel good to you for some reason. He says, listen, man, we're not trying to hurt you. I'm giving you verbatim. We're not trying to hurt you. We want to see you do well. Actually, we want to see 10 black guys like you do well. But we don't want you to do the building downtown. I picked up my file and I walked out of the office. A few days later, I get a call from Madison, Wisconsin, the capital. They called the governor. Told the governor, if you're involved in financing this deal, we think that you should not finance this deal. If you've already allocated financing, you should find a way to withdraw it. The governor's office asked the question, why? I never got the true answer of what they gave him. But I did get an answer from one of the governor's cabinet members. He said, the guys walked into my office and basically threatened me. They called the mayor. They sent nasty emails to the secretary of WIDA that we have. Guys that I had learned from, I respected. All 60-something white men. I've never felt the level of stress. I've been shot before. Never felt the level of stress that I felt on this project. Because at some point, I began fighting for something other than the deal. It wasn't about the deal no more. And really, you know how we are. Anytime we fight for integrity, they're going to be on the losing end of the battle. But they had the most contacts, relationships, money. It almost bankrupted us. That's racism. When they yield all their power to try to destroy or hurt you or harm you or keep you in a space, all because, just because. So where do we go from here? What can you do? This is what I encourage each and every one of you to do. You take the four C's. And those four C's, to me, how I live my life on a square. See, I can't influence what that guy in the back does or what that lady in the back does, but I can control my square. So I'm going to live with integrity. I'm going to do what's right. You can do what's right. You can live with integrity and do what's right on your square. And then what happens is you can start to connect the squares around you. I'll eventually get over there. If I can affect you, and affect you, and then you, and you. But it starts with me. Doesn't start with the president. If you're waiting for that, we've been waiting a long time. And no, and I'm not saying this particular president, even with the last president. Or the president before. I'm not saying the president, the person. I'm saying that position. They don't dictate integrity. You know what's right from wrong. What I'm asking you to do is, even though it may not affect you, or it may affect you in a negative way, you gotta stand up about it. I guarantee you that we will move the needle forward faster than you ever believed if you just speak up and stay committed and show care. You know how surprised some coworkers would be if you made mention of the murders in Chicago last weekend? You have to force yourself out of your comfort zone. You have to force yourself to stay committed, to stay courageous, to care, and to be conscious of all that's going on around you, even in the face of adversity. I am so excited to be here today, and I hope that the times when, and I observe very well, I hope the times when I saw heads low, the yarns, is because it's early in the morning, and not because you weren't interested. But if you were in that seat because your job paid for it and the job told you to come, or because your friend came and you didn't want to feel like, I can't come, then you're part of the problem. Then you are part of the problem. It won't get done with just us. And it won't get done with just me or you or you. It's collective. It reminds me of a story I was told, and you probably heard it before. It's called The Turtle on the Fence Post. And that's what I think about how we moved in history. That turtle represents every time we made progress in history. And it says, if you ever go down a country road and you see a turtle on a fence post, you may not know what it's doing there. But one thing you know for certain is it didn't get there by itself. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. If there are any questions? Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
At this?
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Kalan.
Thank you, Teresa.
At this time, just to stay on task, we have a few minutes for questions, and I will take the mic down, unless there's one down there.
Nope.
No, I'll take it down. And on behalf of the YWCA, we also wanted to make sure that you left with a gift. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Kalan, first off, it's not really just a question, but just an observation and a comment. My name's Sam Liebert. I'm actually the city council president of Janesville, so you can go back to Milwaukee. And
There you go. Will do.
Well, but same situation, single-parent household, born in Milwaukee, came to Janesville for opportunities. And
what? So was that last part? Okay, go ahead.
We used to have a GM plant. But I just want to say thank you for sharing your story. I know sometimes, you know, especially in more diverse crowds from where, from Milwaukee versus Janesville, it can be it's a different audience, and mm-hmm. so you have to kind of play to it. So I understand that. But just thank you for sharing your story and who you came where you came from, and you know, not knowing that that other guy was you. Even showed my own prejudices. I imagined a young thug, and he's got his jeans and his mm-hmm. saggy pants.
How dangerous is that? That's dangerous, right?
Yeah.
Pretty dangerous, right?
Yeah. But it just means a lot to me, and on behalf of our community, thank you for sharing your story. We have a lot of work to do here in Janesville. We have a great police department. Mm-hmm. Chief Moore, we've been actively trying to recruit minority officers to reflect the community that we're policing, and so... It's conversations like these, I think, that help motivate us and reignite the fire and the flame to keep moving forward. So thank you so much.
Thank you, Sam. Appreciate it, man. Appreciate it. And Sam, I want to say, if I could be any help in this discussion, let me know. I saw Chief Moore leave, actually, so I hope that you can tell him that I want to hug when if he's still around here. But it's not personal, but it had to be said. So I want to say thank you and keep it up.
Hi, Kalan. I'm Brian.
Brian.
Thank you for coming today. Saw the announcement for this conference in the paper and read a bit of your biography and said, I think that's a person that I want to hear from. So thank you for making, in a way, you're the reason why I came.
Thank you.
And we hear that term, information is power. And how we get our information... I think it, here's what I'm trying to, I'll get right to it. what is happening? I my heart does hurt for mm-hmm. 300 people dying mm-hmm. in a weekend, mm-hmm. Chicago, Milwaukee. I don't understand. And that's, that information is the power. And not just information, but the truth. And for me, it seems hard to get the truth.
Yep.
And it's a geography, I think.
Mm-hmm.
And some of the other, it's not just geography. But that information is power, and maybe that, for me, that's, you know, to be there, to yeah. go there, to make the relationships, to go there. To live there, and I know there are people who are doing that
yep.
In the communities. So I don't know if there's a question there, but if I could ask for your, how do we get that truth? How do we? Where's the blueprint for that truth and that sharing of the information so that the caring can take action
yep.
in a courageous action?
And I will allude to that later on in another session. But really, we have to get. I said it here. We have to get out of our comfort zone. We have to get. You have to force yourself away from the people that you're used to hear other information. So sometimes you have to watch Fox News to get it. And you said it earlier, you said your heart hurts for the 300 individuals. But think about, take your two statements together. If you hear about a young man dying, the world has become so polluted with perception that, yeah, you heard about any human being dying, but you automatically associate that person with how that person looked. He had to be a thug, and maybe he was doing something wrong, and maybe he shouldn't have been there. And we have to really figure out, one, you have to create the line for yourself of what's acceptable or not. Because even if you get the truth, where do you rank it? So you really got to go back to yourself and say, listen, there was a time when I didn't believe X. And I remember the first time that I saw this. Where did I get it from? You said geography. Well, I prefer to share my story in Janesville. In Milwaukee, they're used to it. It was important for me to share it here. I'm not reluctant to share it. My story is God's plan. It is what it is. But part of, you have to get yourself around other unlike-minded individuals, not like-minded, non-like-minded individuals. One last question.
Roger Hecker from Black Hawk Technical College. And through the college, I'm finding my voice. Mm. And how can I, as a student, project that voice and find the common ground to help people listen? We want to build bridges. We want to make the connections. Mm-hmm. How do we start doing that?
I
think, like you just said, start by finding unlike-minded. And
yep. So, that's one step.
What are other steps?
The other steps is, it seems simple. I'm being redundant. You really got to, it's in you. It starts with you. Because at some point in time, if you carry yourself a certain way, if you're always a person of integrity, certain individuals just don't want to be around you anyway. But you have to be the change you want to see. And you won't be able to hit a home run the first time. But you got to be willing to. You know what? I said, the example I got this week, I was telling a group of women, talking to a group of women, and I said, well, I go out of my way to make sure I hold the door open for women. If I see a woman pumping gas, I make sure I go out of my way to pump her gas or put air in her tire. And the woman said to me, she said, you may not know it, but each time you do that, you change the perception of how people view black men. So for you, do something that nobody else is doing. Make sure that when you're in a room, you sit next to the black person. Walk up to the black person. They'd be surprised. I'm surprised when a white person comes talk to me. What did I do? But that's how you start. That is how you start.